Now in this video lecture, we will go through atomic models, right? Now that we have studied how electrons, protons and neutrons, which are called as subatomic particles of an atom, are discovered, right? And the original theory of Dalton that said that atom is the smallest particle of an element or of any substance was proved wrong. Right now we know that atom is not the smallest particle, but it further consists of smaller particles which are called as subatomic particles, electrons, protons and neutrons. And we know that electrons are negatively charged, protons are positively charged and neutrons are neutral. Right now we will see how these electron, protons and neutrons are distributed in the atom, where exactly these electrons, protons and neutrons are found inside the nucleus, right? We will understand this using atomic models, right? And various atomic models were given at different times by various scientists, but only some were accepted. So here in this video lecture, we will go through two atomic models. First is Thomson's atomic model, and the other was Rutherford's atomic model. Rutherford's atomic model was based on his famous alpha particle scattering model, right, where he bombarded thin metal foils with alpha particles. We would be going through that in detail in a moment. So here, and after the discovery of electron, protons and neutrons, scientists were looking answer for some questions like why atoms combine to form molecules, and the physical and chemical properties of atoms, right, and the nature of electromagnetic radiations emitted or absorbed by atoms. We know that atoms, any substance, right, emit radiations and it also absorbs radiation, right? So they want to, scientists were looking for such explanation at atomic level. Similarly, stability of atom, for the stability of atom, they were looking for answers, and why atoms combine to form molecules, they were looking for this answer based on the stability of atom. Right. So here, now first we will go through Thomson's atomic model. This is Thomson's model. Right. What Thomson said, that atom is a spherical in shape, right, and it has positive charge distributed uniformly throughout that sphere. So atom is a sphere of positive charge, right, and it has electrons embedded in this sphere, in this sphere of positive charge, and this arrangement of electrons and protons, right, is done in such a way so as to have best electrostatic arrangement, or so as to have the stable atom, right, and this arrangement proves us that the neutrality of the atom also. How? Because electrons that are embedded inside the sphere, inside the spherical atom, right, these negative charge due to electrons, right, is neutralized by the positive charge that is distributed in the spherical atom, right? So this somehow explains the neutrality of the atom. And two things about this model. First is that mass of the atom is uniformly distributed throughout the atom, right? And the second thing is the positive charge is also evenly or uniformly distributed around the throughout the spherical atom, right? So important points is, he said that an atom is sphere of positive charge. It has uniform distribution of positive charge, right, and it has electrons like this, electrons embedded in this sphere, right? Now we know the position, the location of protons, right, electrons, neutrons are neutral, right? So they must be within the atom somewhere, right? Because neutrons add only to the mass of the atom, right? So protons, that is positive charge, right, is uniformly distributed within the sphere, right? So this is a sphere of positive charge, and electrons are embedded in this spherical atom, right? And these electrons, this model of atom is compared to watermelon or plum pudding, right? We call it a watermelon or plum pudding model as well. Why? Because if you see watermelon, if you cut a watermelon in two halves, you will see that both the halves, if you see one half, it has black seeds, right? And those black seeds are embedded throughout the watermelon, right? Throughout that spongy red mass, right? So these black seeds in watermelon represents these electrons, right? And the entire sphere or the red mass represents the sphere of positive charge, right? Similarly, why plum pudding model? Because if you will see pudding, you have plums, right, embedded on the pudding, right, embedded on the mass, throughout the mass of that pudding, that cake, right? So you can see those black plums, right? Same as electrons are embedded in this positive sphere, you have plums embedded in that pudding, right? So that is why we compare it with watermelon. We also call it as watermelon or plum pudding model, right? So here we have two important things. First is mass. As per this model, the mass of atom is uniformly distributed throughout this atom. It's not concentrated at one point or at some points. The mass is uniformly distributed throughout the atom, not concentrated at some points. Right? Mass is uniformly distributed. Right? And the positive charge is also evenly distributed. Right? So these two are important points. Mass is uniformly distributed and positive charge is also uniformly distributed. Right? So this model could easily explain the neutrality of the atom. Right? Because the electrons are embedded into this positive sphere in such a manner so as to give most stable electrostatic arrangement. These electrons, right, are embedded in this positive sphere so as to give most stable electrostatic arrangement, or the positive and negative charge will neutralize each other. That is why the atom is neutral. It could explain the neutrality of the atom easily. Neutrality of the atom is explained, right? But this model of atom, Thomson's model, was not successful because it could not justify some results of the later experiments. This model was proved wrong based on the results of some of the experiments. We will see the experiment Rutherford's alpha particle scattering, and we will compare Rutherford's model with Thomson's model, and we'll see how the result of this alpha particle scattering lead to the failure of this model, right? So three important things: mass is uniformly distributed throughout this sphere, right? And positive charge is evenly distributed, and it explained the neutrality of the atom, right? And the size of the radius of the atom is 10 to the power of minus 10 meter, right? This is the radius of the sphere. Now we will go through the Rutherford's scattering experiment, right? This is very important experiment, right? Rutherford, along with his students, the name of the students was Martson, and the other student was Giger and Martson. Two of his students, Hans Giger and Ernest Martson, right? What they did is they took thin foils of metals like gold and silver. They bombarded these thin foils of atoms with alpha particles, right? Rutherford and his students Giger and Martson, right? In this experiment, what we would be doing is bombarding thin sheet of metal, gold. We may also take silver, let's say gold here. Bombarding thin sheet of metal gold with alpha particles, right? Alpha particles are same as helium particles, so we'll call it as helium particles, right? So let's see, these alpha particles, we know that radioactive substances emit alpha, beta, gamma rays. So alpha particle, source of alpha particle would be a radioactive element, a radioactive source, maybe polonium. Right, so this is, let's say this is the, here you have this a radioactive source kept. From this radioactive source, a beam of alpha particles or helium particles would be projected towards the thin sheet of gold metal. Right, here you have this thin sheet of gold metal, and in this experimental arrangement we have a circular sheet, right, a circular sheet of zinc sulfide, right, which is a fluorescent material. We know by fluorescent material we mean that if any ray will fall on this circular zinc sulfide screen, it will shine, right? You will see a bright shine when alpha particle will fall on this sheet, it will produce a bright shine, right, on this fluorescent screen of zinc sulfide, right? So here you have a source of alpha particle, right? Here you have this slit, right? Through this slit, alpha particle, a beam of alpha particle would be bombarded, right, towards this. Beam of alpha particle would be bombarded towards this thin metal foil, right? Now let's see what are the observations when you project a beam of alpha particles to this thin sheet of gold, right? Thin sheet of gold metal. Right, and we know that gold consists of atoms, right? So we would be seeing the interaction of here helium particles or alpha particles with the atoms in the thin sheet of gold, right? So to the observation of Rutherford, what he observed that most of 99.9% of the alpha particles, right, went straight through the gold foil, right? It went undeflected straight through the gold foil. And the second observation was some of the alpha particles were deflected by small angles. Some, very few number of alpha particles were deflected by small angles, right? And the third experiment, and the third was, third observation was that very, very few particles, alpha particles, like 1 in 20,000 were bounced back. That is, they returned back to their path. They were bounced back by an angle of 180 degree, right? So if we try to draw those things, these are, let's say these represent the positive atoms of gold in this thin sheet of gold metal, right? So what they observed, that most of these alpha particles went straight, right? Most of these went straight, right? Only some of the alpha particles, they were deflected by some angles like this, right? And 1 in 20,000, very, very few alpha particles were deflected back, like they went in this direction, then they came back in the same direction. Right, so these are bounced back by 180 degree. These are few alpha particles, few alpha particles deflected by small angles, right? And these, most of the alpha particles passed undeflected. Right. Now we'll see what we can deduce from these three observations. Right. First was most of the alpha particles went undeflected. By undeflected we mean they went straight through these gold atoms, through this sheet of gold, they went straight. That means that most of the space in the atom is empty, right? The atom has, if this is the atom, right, most of it went through like this. It went straight, right? And this shows that most of the space in the atom is empty, right? So this result shows that most of the space within the atom, most of the space is empty, right, within the atom. The second was that few alpha particles were deflected by some angle, right, like this. It deflected by some angle, right? So few deflected by small angles. What could be the reason for this? That few deflected by some few by small angles. It was because deflection. Okay, deflection. What could be the cause of deflection? The cause of deflection and the cause of this bounced, where the particles bounced back by 180 degree. The reason for this is when these alpha particles, we know that alpha particles are positively charged, right? So when they are deflected by angles because they faced a strong repulsive force, right? Due to this repulsive force, these alpha particles are deflected by small angles, right? So that means there is some positive body, right? Positive mass or positive body within the atom, due to which these positively charged alpha particles faced repulsive force, because we know that similar charges repel each other, right? So here in the atom, somewhere we have this positive charge. When this positive beam of alpha particles went near this positive charge, it undergo a deflection due to repulsive force, right? So few particles that were deflected by small angles, it means there is some positively charged body within the atom, right, in some small region. Right, this positively charged body is concentrated within some small region of the atom. It's not that if this is the atom, right, you have this positively charged body in some space, in very small space within the atom. That is why only few of the alpha particles were deflected by small angles. If it would have been like most of this space in the atom was positively charged, like Thomson said, that positive charge is uniformly distributed throughout the atom, then in that case, what we could have expected, that when alpha particles come close to these positive charge, which is distributed uniformly, right, on this positive sphere of atom as per this model, then these alpha particles would slow down, right, and most of the alpha particle will deflect by small angles, right? But here, to our observation, we saw that only some alpha particles were undergo deflection by small angles, because this positive charge which is in the atom due to protons, right, is not uniformly distributed, right, throughout the atom, but is concentrated in small region, right? Very small part of this atom has that positive charge, right? That is why only few particles were deflected. So as per this result, this observation or this Thomson model of atom that says that positive charge is evenly distributed throughout the atom was proved wrong. This point was proved wrong, right? And the first point, if you look at this, if the mass, it says the mass is uniformly distributed, right? Mass is uniformly distributed throughout the atom as per Thomson's model. But our first point where we said that most of the alpha particle went undeflected, that means where we deduced that most of the space is empty, right? We said based on this observation, we said that most of the space within the atom is empty. This space is empty. That is why these alpha particles went straight undeflected, like in empty space. So most of the space is empty, right? And as per the Thomson's model, this says that the mass is uniformly distributed, right? If the mass would have uniformly distributed, right, then this rays of positive charge could not have passed straight, right? It would have been slowed down by this uniform distribution of atom. So using these two observations, these two points were proved wrong of Thomson's model, right? Now let's come to the third point. The third point said that very few particles were bounced back, right? That is, they were deflected back into the source. That is, this is the source of alpha particles, right? So these are deflected back into the source. That is, they are bounced back, right? What could be the reason that these alpha particles are bounced back, right? What could be the reason? The reason is we know that alpha particles are positively charged, right? So if they are bounced back, right, that means they have undergone a collision. We know that since they have bounced back, they are repelled back, right? They are repelled back because of the positive charge in the atom, right? Now they are bounced back, they are retraced to their path, right, because of the head-on collision. These other particles were deflected by small angles because they are close to the positive charge in the atom. When these particles are close to the positive charge in the atom, they are deflected by small angles. But in this case, when they are bounced back, that means the alpha particles have undergone head-on collision. They have collided directly with this positive charge, right? That is why they are bounced back. And the positive charge has some mass, right? It has a, because these alpha particles have also mass, right? So they are deflected back. That means a heavy mass have deflected these positive alpha particles back, right? They have bounced it back. So since only one out of 20,000 particle is bounced back, that means this positive charge, this positive body, right, that have bounced back this alpha particle is concentrated in a very small region of the atom. That is why very, very few particles, 1 in 20,000 is bounced back. Otherwise, if this mass of positive charge have been distributed in more space, more of the particles would have been bounced back. But since very few particles are bounced back, that means this positively charged heavy mass, right, is concentrated in a very small region of the atom, right? So the reason for bounced back is head-on collision with the positively charged mass, right, which is concentrated in a small region of atom, right? So these three are important, right? So based on these three points, Rutherford has deduced his atomic model, which is known as Rutherford's model. We have two important points for Rutherford's atomic model, and we will also see how it could explain the stability of the atom. Right? First was nucleus. So in model of atom, what we are basically seeing is the location of positively and negatively charged particles, right? So based upon his experiment, Rutherford proposed a model of an atom, right? So according to this model, an atom consists of two parts. According to Rutherford's model, atom consists of two parts. First is nucleus, right? And second is extranuclear part. Let's see what these two are. Nucleus is the region from where this head of collision has occurred, right? And this head-on collision has occurred where these positively charged alpha particle have undergone head-on collision. This positively charged particle have undergone head-on collision with the nucleus, right? Because nucleus is positively charged, right? He said that an atom has a nucleus, right? And in the nucleus, we have positive charge. That is why these alpha particles are bounced back, right? And this nucleus, right, is heavily massed. It has a mass. That is, the entire mass of the atom is concentrated in this small part called nucleus, right? That is why it bounced back the alpha particle, right? Because only heavy mass could bounce back the alpha particles, right? It's bounced back. That means it has collided with a heavy mass, right? And that heavy mass has a positive charge. So heavy mass, right, that has a positive charge is called nucleus. And the positive charge is due to the presence of protons inside the nucleus, right? And now we know that neutrons are also inside the nucleus. And the mass of the atom is due to the sum of protons and neutrons, which is present in the nucleus, right? It is present in the nucleus of the atom. So this we could have deduced based on this Rutherford experiment. And extranuclear part is the space that surrounds the nucleus, right? And contains negatively charged electrons, which are revolving around the nucleus at a very high speed, right? Extranuclear part is, this is space around the nucleus. If this is nucleus, then this is space around the nucleus. If this is nucleus, then this is space around the nucleus, right? Where electrons are moving at a very high speed, right? In this extranuclear part. Extranuclear part is space surrounding the nucleus where electrons are moving at a very high speed, right? So this is space around the nucleus and where electrons are moving at a very high speed, and nucleus, which is nucleus that has mass and is positively charged. It has mass plus it is positively charged due to the presence of protons, right? It has mass. This deflection has proved it. That's why these rays are deflected back, because they have collided head on with the positively charged heavy mass. And since electrons are moving at a very high speed around this nucleus, which is positively charged, right? So there must be some force of attraction between this nucleus and those electrons revolving around, right? So why these electrons could be attracted by the nucleus and will fall in the nucleus and will destroy the atom. But this has not happened. Why? Because the electrons that are revolving at a high speed are experiencing a centrifugal force, which is acting outwards. That is balancing this inward attractive force, right? So due to this centripetal force, which has balanced this attractive force, this nuclear force, this electron is balanced and is moving at a high speed and is not falling into this nucleus.